Good morning. Good morning and welcome here to First Mennonite Church, gathered here on Treaty 1 territory and homeland of the Métis Nation. And apparently I feel like I'm in a bit of a jungle right now, like I can reach out and touch the palm branches. It is Palm Sunday. We are entering into Holy Week, starting today with, as I said, Palm Sunday, and then moving into Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and Easter Sunday. This week is a roller coaster of emotion, where we hit some highs today with Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem on a donkey, not a war horse, with crowds waving palm branches. Then we hit some lows with our next service being on Good Friday, where it will take the shape of a funeral for Jesus in the style that we would hold a funeral for our loved ones today. And at the end of the Good Friday service, so you are aware, communion will be served. After Good Friday, we will wait in darkness, mourning Jesus' death, until Easter morning, where we will hit a high as we celebrate Jesus' resurrection. But today, we live in a moment of hopeful joy and celebration as we honor Jesus passing through the crowds in Jerusalem. Before we continue with our service, I would like to acknowledge this morning I got a phone call from Anne Schoenfeld to let me know that yesterday our dear member Tina Ediger passed away at the age of 97. Yeah. So I'd like to take a moment to pray a prayer of blessing for Tina's family. God of light and God of hope, we come to you with gratitude for Tina's life today, for all those 97 years. And we pray a blessing on her family as they mourn her loss and they go through their own highs and lows of remembering the good times and the struggles and of continuing on as they close that chapter of her living with them on this earth and enter into a time of relationship with her now that she is not on this earth anymore and she is with them in spirit. We pray that their family know your peace and your love. Amen. And I would also like to welcome Don Friesen this morning, who will be preaching for us. Thank you very much for Don to come. And also his partner, Dorothy Friesen, is here as well. Do you go by Friesen for your last name? Yes, okay. And Don's sermon title didn't make it into the bulletin, but he will be preaching a sermon titled, What Manner of King? What Manner of Mind? Well, before I met Don, I was emailing with him back and forth this week, trying to get to know him a little bit. I said, can you send me a bit about yourself? And so he said he was born and raised in Saskatchewan. He studied engineering and political science. He said he never did intend to go into the ministry, but sometimes plans change. And he married Dorothy Deckert from Saskatchewan. They have three children, and he is a grandfather. They are grandparents to three grandchildren. They both attended Mennonite Seminary in Elkhart, Indiana. Don was a youth pastor at Bethel Mennonite Church here in Winnipeg in the mid to late 70s. And then he moved to Ottawa, where he was pastor at Ottawa Mennonite Church for many years until 2012 when he retired and moved to Winnipeg. And now he preaches mostly at Grace Bible Church a number of times in the year. Now, I was asking Don to give me information about himself because I thought I'd never met him before. Well, I was mistaken. I was delighted to learn that actually he and Dorothy spent time in Thompson, in the town that I grew up in, and he has a picture of me as an infant in his lap. So we've met before. So, wow, I think I got a tear in my eye when I read that. I was very moved to make that connection. It's not often I get to meet somebody who knows me from my childhood who I didn't know so well. So welcome, a warm welcome to both of you here. After the service today, there is coffee and snacks being served by the youth. Please do come and enjoy some coffee and snacks. And at 11:30, after you've had your snack, there are two options. One is at 11:30 a.m., Carl Stobie will be up in the multipurpose room for adult ed. He is the concertmaster of the Manitoba Chamber Orchestra, and he'll be sharing about the themes of light and darkness in music. Now, the other option is at 11:30, you can come and play all church games in the basement. So whatever suits your fancy, there are options for many, and all are welcome to both. And afterwards, I think we'll all be a little bit hungry from the games and the musings, and there is a potluck lunch. So please come. If you haven't brought, we will stretch the food. The most important thing is that we will be able to visit together. Howard, I invite you to come up and open our service with music.
Sorry, I promise not to do this every week. So just on behalf of Church Council, I just wanted to speak a little bit this morning about our Good Friday service coming up. So we had a couple of calls come in on a similar theme. So in case, I usually presume if one person calls, they're representing more people. If two people call, there's probably a bit of a crew. In case there are more people wondering about the same thing, I wanted to make sure everyone knows what's up. A few weeks ago when I spoke, I know not everyone caught everything I said, so I brought printed notes today, if anyone wants to read through this after the service. So the question that's come up is whether we need to have an ordained pastor to lead communion on Friday. So the short answer is no. I've confirmed with Mennonite Church Manitoba that there's no denominational requirement for an ordained person to lead communion. The long answer is a little more complicated, as they usually are. So we have two main threads in Mennonite churches in the way we treat communion. One thread is our faith in the priesthood of all believers, which means we take seriously the holiness of each person in the body of Christ and recognize that the Holy Spirit can work through any one of us as we serve each other in celebrating the Lord's Supper. The parallel thread is a desire to recognize the holiness of communion, to take it seriously. And while that's looked different in various Mennonite churches at different times, that has often included reserving communion to be led by respected elders, by ordained pastors, or in some cases, church bishops. Some communion traditions have come and gone. My mom recalls during her childhood that people from her church would visit each other before communion to make apologies and mend fences. I've also spoken to some people who remember a tradition of receiving communion in a white handkerchief before it's consumed, so the bread would never touch their hands. I know communion in my time with First Mennonite in just the last few years has been surprisingly varied. The first time I shared communion with this church was virtually due to the pandemic. So I was home alone in front of my computer, as likely many of you were. I had some pretty decent wine and some very stale rice crackers. And I'm glad that has not become our permanent practice. I was also with Erica in 2022 when she led communion for the first time outdoors in a downtown park for those of us from First Mennonite who had gathered to walk together in the Pride Parade. In my discussion with Mennonite Church Manitoba, they suggested that specific practices in recognizing communion have tended to live more at the congregational level than at the denominational level. So I'm not sure about all the past documents of the 98 years of this church, but our current church constitution calls for communion to be celebrated at least 3 times per year, and makes leading communion the responsibility of our leading minister or another minister of the congregation that the leading minister has delegated that role to. Monica and Zach, as ministers of our congregation, will lead our Good Friday service, including communion, acting in that delegated role. I know most of you don't see the worship schedule ahead of time, but this isn't a change to the schedule in response to the leave. This was already on the schedule when I stepped in to help schedule and fill some gaps in the preaching schedule. One element to consider here is that we are a church that has called 3 new pastors to serve here just last year, and we should expect to see the newer members of our pastoral team doing things here for the first time. We simply can't ask or expect that our leading pastor will personally attend to everything. I know some people would love to hear that there won't be any more change at church, but I can't promise you that. There have been a lot of changes in the last few years, and I am certain that more changes are coming. I can offer to you that we can continue to walk together as a church through the changes that have come and the changes that will come, and I can offer that we can always talk together about what we find surprising or joyful or uncomfortable when things change. When we gather to celebrate the Lord's Supper on Good Friday, we'll meet as we typically do, led by ministers of this congregation, celebrating a closed communion of the baptized, recognizing the commitments made during baptism, and the serious commitments of those who continue to consider baptism in the future. We will gather as those who are certain and those who are doubting, those who walk confidently and those who are taking timid steps in our walk of faith, those who are looking to see if there's a place at the table for them, and those who are looking for familiar reassurance. We will gather in person, and we will gather virtually, in faith that however we gather, Christ will be present with us. However you come on Friday, we will gather together. I hope you come hungry.
Hosanna!
Thank you, Howard and Alana, for opening our service with praises and Hosanna. For our Lenten liturgy this morning, I think it's a good way to follow this opening song. Let us turn in our bulletins to the opening liturgy. You get to repeat the same thing three times, and some of you were going to have palm branches already, but we didn't pass them out right away at the beginning, but you'll get them later, don't worry. Let's speak with the same energy that Howard sang with for this opening liturgy, and we're gonna practice. I'll speak it out the way I invite you to speak it out, and then you get a turn to practice. Stick with me here, wake up. Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Your turn. Hosanna. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. I think that's great. Let's start all together. I'll read the part of all with you, and then I'll read the part of leader. Let's join together. Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Christ among us, humble and riding on a donkey. Hosanna. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Christ among us, God's light shining on us. Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Christ among us, showing us the way of a servant. Let's stand to sing Hosanna Loud, Hosanna number 313. In your purple books. If you do not have a purple book, wave your hand and we'll grab one for you. Gerhard, can you give one in the back there? Thanks. Let's stand to sing 313. And this is a song that reminds us that Jesus acknowledges children in his midst and shows them his love. Let's sing.
True.
see Laura passing out the palm branches and faces lighting up as we get to hold plants in church for the children. That's lovely. Thank you, Laura, for that. Let us spend some time in prayer. Please join with me in a posture of prayer. Jesus, you came to Jerusalem riding on a donkey. A donkey. You were not what the people expected for a king. And yet you made an impact so deep that centuries later, people still draw near to your broad and all-encompassing love that comes to us in humility instead of bravado. What kind of love is this? It is not the love we experienced as a child when our teacher yelled at us out of exasperation when we messed up. It is not the kind of love we gave as a fearful teenager when we lashed out at a friend who annoyed us when we were tired. It is not the kind of love we gave when we said hurtful words to our young adult children when they chose a path we did not approve of. Yours was not that kind of love. It was a love so full of grace and forgiveness, understanding and beauty, that people came flocking to you in varied places to hear your stories, to muse at this new way to love neighbor and self as God loves us. As you, Jesus, love us. Holy Jesus, open us to this love. Let us come flocking to you in our joy, in our pain, with our petitions, and let it set us free. Then out of that place of love and freedom, let us, through you, bring that freedom and love to our lost, to our sick, to our forgotten, to our elderly, to our newborn, to our colleagues, to our caregivers, to our leaders locally and abroad. Let us bring that love with us when we listen to the news, when we vote, sign petitions, roll down our window at an intersection to spare some change, when we open our church to organizations that multiply that love like you did with the loaves and fishes. Holy Jesus, open us to this love. We will unite our voices now, Lord Jesus, with ancient words that you gave us, that we seek to find meaning in as we speak our petitions to God through these words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I invite the children to come forward. I think you should bring your palm branches with you. Laura is going to tell the children's story. Come on up.
Working? Yes. How are you doing today? Does anybody want another palm leaf? We have all kinds of palm leaves up here. Did you know these were palm leaves?
Yeah.
Why do we have palm leaves today? Anybody? What day is today? Does anybody know what today is? Somebody want one of these? Here you go. We have all kinds of palm leaves. I have a picture here, and you guys can have a chance to color some of these downstairs later. What's this a picture of? What do the people have? Palm leaf. And who said that? Jesus riding on a donkey. And the people are sitting around with palm leaves. They look like they're waving them around. Can you guys do what these people are doing in the picture? Yeah. Why would people stand around waving palm leaves at Jesus? What do you think?
Maybe because he's the new king.
Excellent. Yes, exactly. On Palm Sunday, we remember that it's the middle of Lent, right? And we have the cross here, and we've been putting out the candles because it's a solemn time, and we're preparing for the day that Jesus died. And it's kind of sad, but Palm Sunday is a bit of a celebration in the middle of it. On Palm Sunday, Jesus rode a donkey. Now, does a king usually ride on a donkey? What would a king usually ride on?
A horse?
Something fancier, right? Maybe a horse. Do you have an idea? What would a king ride on? But he rode on a donkey, and he rode into Jerusalem.
In a carriage?
Yes, the queen still rode in a carriage, and the king still rides in a carriage. The king of England rode in a carriage when he got crowned, right? But Jesus rode a donkey. And often when a king comes into a town or a city, there's bands playing, and there's soldiers marching, and there's all kinds of fancy stuff going on. Does anybody know what it means to roll out the red carpet? Has anybody heard of that? What does it mean? What's a red carpet? Besides a red carpet, but what does it mean when there's a red carpet?
Like a fancy person's coming.
A fancy person's coming. And so they have things like, oh, did you want to talk about the red carpet?
A red carpet is when you roll it and then the king walks on it.
Yes. It's a fancy carpet for somebody important. But Jesus didn't.
It's for somebody to walk.
That's right, and somebody important and special. They still do it for like the Oscars. They have the red carpet and all the fancy people walk on it. But Jesus didn't have a red carpet. But what are these people in this picture doing? What are they putting down on the ground in front of Jesus? Palm leaves, that's right. And so on Palm Sunday, we remember that Jesus rode into Jerusalem and the people knew he was special. And they knew he was a special king. And we keep hearing in the singing today and in the speaking, we've heard the word Hosanna, which is kind of like a hallelujah, but it also means save us. So they knew Jesus was special and he could do wonderful things. And so they were celebrating him coming into the city. They weren't sure. They didn't know that he was going to die. They thought he was going to be a king here on earth. Is that the kind of king he was? Was he a king like King Charles in England? No, he was not that kind. He wasn't a red carpet king, was he?
He was new.
He was a new kind of king. And he came for us. And he didn't come to be fancy and live in a castle.
And he didn't have a red carpet because he was not in a castle. Or he was born in a barn.
That's right. He was born in a barn. And his mom rode a donkey to get to that barn too. And he was just a humble person. But he did come to help us and to save us, didn't he, with his message. And he showed how powerful he was when on Easter Sunday he rose again. But on Palm Sunday, we get to celebrate that special day when Jesus rode into Jerusalem and everybody celebrated him and people knew he was a king. Now, we're going to go downstairs and do some special activities down there, to do some coloring and things. And I think the youth should go down to help prepare for to serve after the message. And are you guys ready to go downstairs? Okay, let's go down. Should we take the palm?
Fun times. Let's pray a prayer of dedication for the offering. God, we come with palm branches waving in celebration of Jesus and want to offer our gifts of joy and enthusiasm. We come waving our palm branches and our donations of time and money to place them in your hands as our offering today. We come with gratitude for all that we have and pray that it is enough for you to work through us in the world. In your name we pray, amen. And our donations are gathered when you leave the sanctuary, either at the basket there or at the back of the sanctuary, or if you're listening online with the donate button online. Howard, I invite you to sing another Palm Sunday song for us. Switching gears, switching gears from this ride on King Jesus, power and energy and delight, to a time of confession. Let us turn in our bulletins to the Lenten Litany of Confession. I will read the part of leader, and together we will read the part of all. I will begin. When we get caught up in embracing the world's power, forgive us. When we lose sight of the humble donkey and put our trust in horses of war, remind us of this Palm Sunday. When we begin to get sucked into the darkness of the now, bring us once again the peace of looking toward the not yet. Let us turn in our purple books to number 581, our Lenten theme song. Let's remain seated for this song. Lord Jesus, you shall be my song. We have one verse to sing today to match the one remaining candle that will be extinguished as we sing, because it is the sixth Sunday in Lent. I'll read the verse one that we will sing. Lord Jesus, you shall be my song as I journey. I tell everybody about you wherever I go. You alone are our life, peace, and love. Lord Jesus, you shall be my song as I journey. As we sing, I invite you to think of a mantra or a prayer that you have as your song that you sing as you journey, a song that is your prayer and your guiding light. This song, as I read this text, it reminded me of Kathy Giesbrecht's sermon from last week, in which she names that there are many who long to hear the good news of the gospel. And how do we tell everybody about Jesus wherever we go? Do we say it with our words? I think often by our actions, by the love we show, who we align with when there is injustice, how we respond in conflict, and by how we carry ourselves with confidence, respect, and humility. Let's sing verse one. I will be reading from the Psalms and from the book of Mark, Psalm 118, verses 1 to 2 and 19 to 29. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks for you. You are my God, and I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his steadfast love endures forever. From the book of Mark, chapter 11, verses 1 to 11. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here immediately.'" They went and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the king, blessed is the coming king of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. I invite you, Dawn, to come up.
Today is Palm Sunday, a day to meditate on the day that Jesus entered Jerusalem, a day to mark the beginning of Holy Week. Centuries ago, Jerusalem was excited about an unusual guest coming that day. The crowds lined the road into the city to get a good look at him. It was Jesus. And when he entered the city at Passover, it was crowded with pilgrims, all fired up with great expectations. It was a royal entrance, or at least the crowds treated it as such. They spread their cloaks in front of him, just like they did in the Old Testament when Jehu, son of Jehoshaphat, was proclaimed king. They waved palm branches, just like they had years before when Simon Maccabeus entered Jerusalem after a notable military victory. They shouted Hosanna, a form of praise reserved for kings. They called him Son of David, underlining Jesus' royal ancestry. The Gospel of Mark proclaims, "Blessed is the King. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David." Matthew presents Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem as a fulfillment of prophecy, quoting the Old Testament prophet Zechariah, "Behold, your King comes to you." It is the kingliness of Jesus that is presented as one of Davidic and therefore royal ancestry. The Gospel of Luke lays more stress on Jesus' humility as evidenced by his choice of a donkey as his steed. But Luke too explains Jesus' kingdom for the crowds, or underlines the king theme, for the crowd shouted, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." And when some of the Pharisees wanted the acclamation to stop, Jesus said, I tell you, if they were silent, even the stones would shout out. Today is an appropriate day to explore the nature of Jesus' royalty. What kind of king was he? To whom should we compare him? Well, one of the more famous kings in our more recent history, specifically our Commonwealth history, was King Henry VIII. Henry was only 18 years old when he ascended to the throne. Despite his youth, Henry was an ambitious king. He made radical changes to the English Constitution. He ushered in the divine right of kings, although I can't see that being of any benefit to anyone except himself. He greatly expanded royal power during his reign, convenient for putting down any dissent. He frequently used charges of treason to quell dissent, and those accused were often executed without a formal trial. If any of his chief ministers fell out of favor with him, they were banished or executed. One is only to remember the fate of Thomas More, who served as Henry's Lord High Chancellor. More served a mere 3 years. For when he refused to take the oath of supremacy, he was convicted of treason and executed. Then there was the matter of Henry's wives, all six of them. The sheer number of them is embarrassing enough, but his efforts to have his marriage to Catherine of Aragon annulled led Henry to separate the Church of England from papal authority. Henry appointed himself head of the Church of England and dissolved convents and monasteries for which he was excommunicated by the Pope. If that wasn't bad enough, creating a universal church schism for the mere matter of domestic convenience, Henry then used the proceeds from the dissolution of the Catholic monasteries for his own royal coffers. It also fed his personal extravagance. King Henry VIII was frequently characterized in later life as a lustful, egotistical, paranoid, and tyrannical king. When I review Henry VIII's kingship, I'm not seeing any parallels to the kingship of Jesus. Sure, there have been more benevolent, less selfish kings in our history, but the default seems to be to accrue power and to do it at whatever cost. Jesus' kingdom did not accrue power. For already in Jerusalem, the recognition that greeted King Jesus on his arrival was not sustained, and the focus of the story changes swiftly from palms to passion, from shouts of Hosanna to shouts of Crucify Him. Jesus' triumphal entry celebrates his kingliness, but the passion that follows is a tragic example of human fickleness. Nevertheless, there is a royal posture that characterizes Jesus' life and passion, and I would like to suggest that there are at least seven marks of Jesus' kingship. Firstly, we recognize that this king is different from other kings. This is an unusual king. For one thing, kings are not usually poor, but Jesus and his family were poor. This is also a king who faced temptation and whose crown was a crown of thorns. His crowning achievement was death on a cruel cross. As most kings do, King Jesus laid out his royal program, only his speech from the throne called for poverty of spirit. It called for meekness, for mercy, for purity of heart, for the making of peace. He compared the subjects of his kingdom to salt and light, suggesting this was a community destined to make a positive impact on the world. This king, unlike other kings, rode into the city on a donkey. You would not see an Egyptian pharaoh entering a city on a donkey. You would not see a Roman governor on a donkey. Jesus was different, unusual. This was not the warrior king many expected, entering a city on a well-trained war horse, followed by an army of well-armed soldiers. This was not a wealthy king covered in jewels and strutting to the music of military marching bands. This is the Prince of Peace. himself the beast of burden who came to bear upon his back the sins of this world. So this is an unusual king. Secondly, this is a king in need. We witness his need when we look at the gospel story of the Gethsemane experience. Jesus needed several things. He needed to pray. He needed to count the counsel of his heavenly Father. We read, in fact, that he fell on his face and prayed, the most humbling of all postures for prayer. We read that he withdrew to pray three times, each time a wrenching experience for him. He was wrestling with deep spiritual matters. Jesus needed to be alone with God, but at the same time, he seemed to need the companionship of his disciples. And so he had invited several of them to accompany him, and while the personal support they lent to him was meager, it seemed important to Jesus to have them there. Just before the triumphal entry into Jerusalem, Jesus also needed a donkey. He needed someone to provide the upper room for the Last Supper, and later he would need a generous benefactor to provide a burial plot for him. What manner of king is this? A king whose resources are so meager that he has to scrounge things simply to enter the city. Not only is this a king in need, it is thirdly a sorrowful king. When he came to Gethsemane, Jesus began to be grieved and agitated, or as another translation has it, sorrowful and troubled. One of the Greek words the gospel uses to describe Jesus' state of mind is a word that denotes distress, anguish, and misery. A word used to describe one's state of mind when one doesn't know what to do or where to turn. The sorrow of Christ is expressed heart-wrenchingly in his cry from the cross, "Eli, Eli, lima sabachthani? My God, why did you abandon me?" The kingly acclaim offered him at his entrance to the city had by now deserted him, and he almost appears to cling to his disciples, freely sharing his sorrow. However surprising it may seem that Jesus underwent such anguish and dismay, it stuck in the memory of several New Testament writers, among them the writer of Hebrews, who records, "In the days of the flesh, in the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears." Fourthly, this is a king destined to suffer. It's interesting that the gospel writers spare us the details of the crucifixion. Perhaps it was impolite to talk about the gruesome particulars. In the century before Jesus, Cicero, a great Roman statesman, spoke disparagingly of the use of the crucifixion. He wrote, "How grievous a thing it is to be disgraced by a public court. How grievous to suffer banishment. The executioner, the veiling of the head, and the very word cross should be far removed, not only from the person of a Roman citizen, but his thoughts, his eyes, and his ears. For it is not only the actual occurrence of these things, but the very mention of them that is unworthy." Jesus, however, suffered this most degrading punishment, one generally reserved for slaves and criminals. The New Testament underscores the humiliation of this punishment by describing how he was mocked repeatedly. The rulers that be mocked the idea of a savior who could not save himself. The soldiers mocked him as a powerless king. And one of the criminals crucified along Jesus mocked his inability to save either himself or those dying with him. Luke portrays a king, but it's a vulnerable king, a feeble king, a king destined to suffer. Luke mentions Jesus' kingship, or similar titles, six times in his gospel, and while the inscription "King of the Jews" is mentioned twice and is meant as mockery by those saying it, Luke intended it as truth. Though born to be a king, Jesus' particular brand of kingship led him down a path of suffering. Born of a peasant woman, raised in poverty, discouraged and moved to tears like any other human being, suffering pain, betrayal, abandonment, and finally a torturous and humiliating death, Jesus went through it all. Fifthly, Jesus is an obedient king. Jesus asked God while praying in Gethsemane, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me." The cup was a symbol of suffering, and so Jesus' plea is that he be spared this particular destiny. His request reflects his intense struggle to bring his own will into conformity with the will of God. As Jesus continues to pray, he seems in a gradual way to become a little more determined to take the cross upon himself, though he admits that while the spirit may be willing, the flesh is weak. God does not answer Jesus' prayer, at least no answer is recorded in the Gospels. The silence of God, however, conveys the assurance that there's no other way possible. Jesus came to that conclusion himself, for as his prayer session comes to an end, we see once again the resolute Jesus, waking up his disciples and declaring, "The hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let's be going. My betrayer is at hand." Through spiritual struggle and prayer, Jesus was given the strength and power to say, "Not my will, but thine be done." He chose the cross. He could have refused the cup that God was holding out to him, but he chose to drink it. He chose Calvary. He could have played it safe, but he would have forfeited God's will for him. It was because a suffering world needed a suffering Savior that Jesus courageously and obediently went to Jerusalem to his death. He chose to suffer because he realized that his suffering was a means of redemption. By his stripes, his wounds, we receive healing. Sixthly, Jesus was a humble king. Recent centuries have shown us kings who were ruthless tyrants. King Henry VIII was not alone. We associate kingship with power and absolute and abusive power. Today we have rulers like Vladimir Putin. The early Christians had the most famous tyrant of all, Nero. Nero's mother, Agrippina, was even worse. She married Emperor Claudius and persuaded him to adopt Nero and to name the boy as his successor. And as the emperor grew older, Agrippina herself began a reign of terror, killing those she thought might oppose Nero's adoption. Her husband caught on to her scheme, but on the day he planned to disinherit Nero, the young man and his mother fed Claudius poisonous mushrooms. After 12 hours of terrible suffering, Claudius died, and the 17-year-old Nero became emperor. Agrippina may have thought she now had a firm grip on power, but later, when she opposed Nero's divorce, he attempted to have her drowned, his own mother. She swam to safety, but he then sent assassins to her home and had her killed. Such was the character of Nero, and such, unfortunately, has been the evil character of many kings throughout history. One expects kings to wield power, but that's where Jesus' royalty takes a strange turn. When at the time of Jesus' arrest, Peter got a little agitated and took a sword to the ear of one of the high priest's servants, Jesus said to him, "Put your sword back, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I can't appeal to my Father and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels?" Jesus chose not to call upon them. This is also a king who, at his most vulnerable, reaches out to a criminal on the cross alongside him and extends forgiveness. This king came to reconcile us to God and to one another. This is a king who stoops. It's not something we're accustomed to seeing kings do. But it's powerful when it happens. King Hussein of Jordan, not long before the onset of the cancer that took his life, undertook a small mission. He paid a personal visit to the families of some Israelis who had been killed in an Arab terrorist bombing. There was no talk of money or reparations. Instead, the king sat quietly with the mourners and by his calm demeanor and undivided attention conveyed a sense of solidarity with them. The reaction of the relatives was out of proportion to the simplicity of the act. They were deeply moved. Their grief had been acknowledged, and even more memorable, it had been acknowledged and shared by a king. We don't generally recognize royalty in one who stoops, but that is the royal posture portrayed in Philippians, where Paul writes, Jesus humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even on death on a cross. Therefore, meaning that's why, God highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Seventhly and finally, this is a king who appeals to our love. When you think of kings like Nero and their reign of terror, and then consider that in this very context, Jesus tried to model a different kind of kingship, we can only marvel at him. Christ was a new kind of king. Even in his own tradition, he was not a King Saul, revered for his physical strength and military prowess. He was not a King Solomon, whose wealth and wisdom were vivid memories for Israel. He did not even measure up to his own ancestor, the revered King David. While most monarchs of his time and ancestry appealed to fear to bolster their power and authority, there was nothing fearful about Jesus. His compassion banished fear. His is a kingship of the heart. He appealed not to fear, but to love. His entrance into Jerusalem on a donkey signaled a king who came in peace. He appealed, and he continues to appeal, to our trust, much as he himself trusted in God. As we read about Jesus in the Gospels, we ask ourselves, what manner of king is Jesus? As I have outlined, he is an unusual king, a needy king, a sorrowful king, a king destined to suffer. He is, thanks be to God, an obedient king, a humble king, and a king who appeals to our love. On this special day in the life of Christ and in the life of the church, it may be enough simply to remember our Lord as someone whose kingliness was unique. But our Lord expects more than our admiration. He calls for our love and our obedience. We pray with the Apostle Paul that we may gain Christ and be found in him, that we may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. Like the disciples in Gethsemane, we may be inattentive to the spiritual struggles of others. We may lack humility. We may shy away from obedience. The New Testament, however, encourages Christian maturity, reaching, as Ephesians encourages us, toward the measure of the full stature of Christ. As we open our hearts to the will of God and to the prompting of His Spirit, we realize that we are called not only to wave palms, but to partake of Christ's passion. For to truly know Christ is to take up his cross and follow him. Just as Jesus, in the course of his prayers, brought his will into conformity with God's will, so most of us have our own Gethsemanes to work through and to pray over until we too can finally say with serenity, "Thy will be done." The Apostle Paul wrote to the Christians in Philippi, let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. When Paul speaks of the mind of Christ, he's talking more about more than one's brain. He is talking about one's whole being. Paul writes, let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. What manner of mind would dare to walk willingly to his death? What manner of mind would choose to enter triumphantly into the very place that placed the price on his head? What manner of mind would do this when lesser minds would have tried all manner of ways to avoid a cruel crucifixion? What manner of mind would remain unmoved by the popular acclaim of the crowds, knowing full well they would turn on him when the party was over, making this march to the cross a very lonely, very solitary one? What manner of mind? An obedient mind. And for the sake of a nobler purpose, because he loved God with all of his heart, all of his soul, and all of his mind. What manner of mind? A wondrous mind. As the hymn expresses it, a wondrous mind is this that caused the Lord of bliss to bear the dreadful curse for my soul. A wondrous mind whom we worship and acclaim as Lord and King, the King of Kings, whose kingdom shall never end. Praise God. Amen.
Thank you, Don. Let us open our hymn books to 564, What Wondrous Love Is This, and sing those words that Don closed his sermon with. Let us stand.
Oh,
Let us rise for the benediction and the closing hymn. Remember that there is coffee and snacks served after the service in the basement, adult ed in the multipurpose room at 11:30, and games in the basement. Everyone is welcome. As we go out from here with joy and celebration, remembering our King, humble and riding on a donkey, we journey with Christ this week on the path of servanthood, sacrifice, and pain. What will we find on the other side as we follow him? Let us turn to number 412, sing verses 1 and 4 of My Soul Cries Out.